graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents The Great Insurrection, Book 5, Prometheus Unites, by David Beers and Michael Anderle. Narrated by Terence Aselford and performed by a full cast.
The written history of the Great Insurrection. 3 months had passed, and life had changed tremendously for all of us. Our people had a planet to live on, and Prometheus immediately went to work on the board, the laboratories, and understanding the complex economy of this planet, as well as the nature of the life that had been made here. Not just the gigantes and the rocks, but the other life forms too. He would deny the term, but for all intents and purposes, he was the ruler. People brought questions to him, and he found the answers. For those 3 months, I think it was as close to peace as we ever knew during this entire endeavor, at least for most of us. I could see the itch in Prometheus, the desire to get moving, to find his way back to his wife. He held firm during those months, however, knowing where his duty lay. He had come to a planet and killed their leaders. He had to make things right, or right as he could. The universe has a strange arc to it. We had found peace. Phaetron and I, Servia, even the All-Mother. The old one who had brought us all together didn't rush anyone. She seemed at home on this strange new planet. She rested a lot, and though she still looked weaker than she had on Pluto, her strength began returning. The universe, though, wouldn't let us have that peace. The eyes that had fallen on us decided it would be better to kill us than let us live in peace. Perhaps those distant warlords recognized another warlord when they saw one. They understood that Prometheus wouldn't be sated by this planet, and while they misunderstood his end goal, they saw a war in his future. So those warlords came to snuff out the new warlord, and our peace ended.
The planet was a cold one, with snow and ice stretching as far as the eye could see. There were no roads, and anyone who came to this place was forced to travel by air or by animal. It had been cheaper to build transports than roads. A nondescript one-story building sat in the middle of the tundra. There were no other structures in sight, only the transports that had arrived 30 minutes ago. There were three main groups of transports on three different sides of the building about a mile away. Some men and women occupied them, while others stood in the snow, wrapped in layers of clothing and holding weapons. No one standing outside the building dared fire on an opposite cohort. To do so would mean destruction for all involved. Those outside the single-story building waited for the people inside. The two men and one woman inside the building had not met face-to-face in 10 years, not since the last war that had gone on for far too long. The death toll had finally grown so high that the three warlords were forced to sit down and bargain. For 10 years, their shaky peace had held. Now, a new warlord, a man from Earth no less, threatened their peace. Those on the outside didn't know what was being said. They only hoped that the people inside managed not to kill one another and could somehow find a way to stop the force of nature known as Prometheus. Cristin de Monaham was thin, and she was from this cold world. Living on a cold world since birth made one hard, or it killed one. There were no other options. Gaylor de Brinston was the fattest of the group. A scar stretched down the side of his tan face, and he usually wore his long hair back, not bothering to hide the war trophy. Simo de Columbus was between the woman and the other man in weight. His hair was cropped close to his head, and his eyes were like stones. Behind each of them stood his or her second in command. Each warlord used different titles for these people, but it amounted to the same thing. The seconds were here to remember what was said and to light a cigar or cigarette if such a thing were requested. In short, they would act as servants and confidants. The position was coveted and only bestowed on one person until their death or retirement. Cristin spoke first. Her voice was naturally soft, sounding much like the cold wind that blew across the wilderness outside.
We all know why we're here. Something has to be done. The question is, how should we deal with him?
Simo, who was sitting directly across from Cristin, spoke next. He waved his hand like he was swatting a bug as he began.
His quarrel is not with us. It was with that corporation and those monsters they breed, or the Commonwealth from Earth. Why should this concern me?
Gaylor raised his eyebrows.
The monsters they breed? How many gigantes do you have in your service? How many are sitting out there in the snow right now? And don't act like the three of us are without guilt when it comes to selling those monsters.
The two men looked at Cristin. Her business was not as widespread as the others, but it was growing. She bred the creatures to create a solid alternative to what had once been a monopoly. Simo shook his head.
I was against that business from the start. It still has nothing to do with me.
Kristen's face was a mask of disdain.
If he comes for me, Simo, he'll come for you, too. Why stop with my army? Why not free the gigantes you two possess? You're being stubborn right now, and I'm not sure why. You didn't come here to tell the two of us no, so can we stop this charade?
Simo grew quiet. The woman's words were true. Their armadas hadn't flown to this world because they thought this man wasn't a threat.
It's a pretty wide opening, especially since he took out the Daxes and their board. He may have halted production there, but we can get it started again fairly quickly. If we go there and end his little rebellion, the bred-for-hire mercenary market would be ours.
His little rebellion destroyed the largest mercenary corporation in our galaxy. Underestimate this man at your peril, Dave Brinston.
The fat man placed his hands on his ample stomach.
I'm not underestimating him. I'm not overestimating us, either. He took out the Daxes by utilizing a glitch in their breeding process. He was stronger than them, and they ended up without the necessary warriors to fight back. That's not going to happen here.
He nodded at Cristin.
Her breeding is different, for one thing. And two, our militaries are not based on the Gigantes. He won't be able to turn them against us. He won, through luck or strategy, I don't know. But neither of those things will work against us.
He leaned forward on the table, his scar prominent under the bright light.
He did us a favor by taking out the Daxes. I vote we go there and remove him from power as he did them.
He leaned back in the chair.
We can work out the details about management and profit sharing later.
Cristin and Gaylor looked at Simo. Gaylor shrugged, still leaning back in the chair.
Things remain as they are here, but Cristin and I will go kill this Titan. We'll share the profits of this endeavor.
All three knew what that meant and why Gaylor had said it. The big man thought the chances of them winning with Simo were higher. Perhaps they even needed him. Yet, if they went forward and he didn't, his position would be weakened as the other two gained more credit and power, at least over time. Simo gave a small nod, knowing that to join them might mean death, but to sit it out would almost certainly mean the same. The Titan might be dangerous, but Gaylor was right. However he had won, it couldn't be repeated. In some ways, the Daxes had set themselves up to be defeated by creating a primitive creature who would follow any strong man who came along. The Daxes had thought themselves so intelligent, so high above the crime lords they sold to. They had engineered the creatures and created a legal enterprise, though they'd been nothing more than common criminals. Now they were dead.
I'm in.
They all nodded. Planning would come next, but that was just details. The Titan was as good as dead. The warlords were gathering in another galaxy as Alexander De Finita, 10th Imperial Ascendant, decided his next move. His spies had told him of Alistair Kane's newest triumph. The former Titan had gotten himself an army, apparently by destroying the heads of a corporation that De Finita had never heard of. The universe was truly vast, and even the Imperial Ascendant was learning how far humanity had stretched. He'd kept his empire contained to the solar system, but he was now wondering if he shouldn't venture out farther once this threat was eliminated. Alexander had spoken to Chaos a few hours before. The old propraetor was taking Kane seriously, and he was whipping the other propraetors into fighting shape. Alexander had called a meeting with them for next week. They would all travel to Earth. Some were probably already on their way, and he planned on letting them all know the stakes. The fathers had called Alexander early this morning. Clearly, the same message he'd received had also been delivered to them. The dead bastards in the orb were starting to get on his nerves, and he wished more than anything he could simply shut down the whole system. Yes, his forebears lived inside the artificial intelligence system, and yes, it had helped the Commonwealth rule the solar system with an iron fist. But goddamn, it was annoying. Perhaps it was petty for an Ascendant to be thinking in such terms, but he couldn't help it. He hated the fathers right now. Alexander knew he couldn't shut them down, though. Whatever he might personally think about Kane, he knew his duty, and they weren't wrong. The ex-Titan's strength was growing by the day. The message Alexander had sent about Kane's wife hadn't worked. It felt like a lifetime ago that they'd had Kane on the dreadnought. Back then, Alexander had felt as if he were somewhat in control of the man. He had been. No longer. They couldn't play an offensive game. Now, they would have to wait for the ex-Titan to return. And he would. Alexander held no doubt about that. The fathers could calculate everything, and Alexander could access their calculations without having to go see them. This man, Kane, was blinded by his love for his wife, Luna. There was a 97% chance he would return to see her, which to Alexander was insane. He could understand devotion to one's progeny and one's lineage, but to a woman, it was lunacy. He smirked at his own little joke as he walked down the corridor to her room in the Imperial Palace. That madness clarified things for Alexander, though. The propraetors were important, but the woman Luna was key. Controlling her was crucial to winning this. It might be the only way now.
Don't be dramatic. You sound like the fathers. He might have an army of half-breed mutants, but you control a star system.
He'd kept her isolated for the past month, knowing that isolation would cause psychological issues and make her more prone to accept him as her savior. He also wanted to see if she'd talk about what had happened on her own. She hadn't yet, but maybe the isolation would force it. She'd had contact with her servants, but no one of any importance. To the outside world, the ex-Titan's wife had simply disappeared. Her father was beginning to cause issues, and the man held some sway on Earth. Nothing the Ascendant couldn't handle, but he knew he'd have to let the woman speak to someone soon. Yet the isolation had been necessary. Because Alexander understood that something had happened with the woman, just as something had happened with the fathers. They had almost demanded that he march down to her room the moment they felt it and question her. Alexander had seen the security video from her room. The fathers were positive the ex-Titan had somehow managed to travel across space in a way never before seen. They said they'd spoken to the man. Alexander didn't believe it, of course. He'd had the AI run multiple systems checks, but it had detected no abnormalities. On the security video, the woman had asked who was in her room. There was shock on her face. She was trembling and crying. All of it made Alexander wonder what had taken place. He still didn't believe what the fathers had told him, and that was why he'd waited before talking to her. Alexander wanted Luna Kane primed to talk, not to continue the game she was so adept at playing. Alexander wanted to kill her, just as he did the fathers, but he understood that might doom the entire Commonwealth. Right now, she could be used as a pawn, but if she died, it would ignite something in the ex-Titan that nothing in the universe could extinguish. Alexander realized it would be like setting off a supernova right next to Earth. If he kept her alive, she could still be used. He reached her door. His body's signature could open it, but he had more decency than to do that to a lady. He waved his hand in front of the panel on the left side of the door and waited for her to check the panel on her side. After a few moments, the door opened by sliding into the wall. The Ascendant stepped in.
Salve, Luna.
Luna sat with her back to him, a data track open on the table in front of her. He monitored everything that went through that thing, and much of the outside world was blocked from Luna. As she well knew, the Ascendant understood that her back turned to him was a message in itself.
Salve, Imperial Ascendant.
She didn't look at him.
Am I free to leave the Imperial residence, or am I a captive here?
She turned around and faced him. She looked different than she had when she'd first arrived. She'd lost weight, and there were circles beneath her eyes, dark ones that spoke of the insufficient sleep that she got at night.
Would you like to leave, Luna?
Alexander folded his hands behind his back.
I'd like to know what is happening and why I've been denied access to my family. I've willingly done what you asked. I've been on board with everything you've requested, my liege, but I'm being treated like a prisoner.
She gestured at the data track.
Even the information I'm allowed to see is restricted.
It's for our safety, Luna.
Oh, I'm a danger to you now. A woman who's never used a weapon in her life.
The Ascendant made his way to a chair next to one of the windows. He sat and looked outside. The windows in this room couldn't be broken, so the woman wasn't able to throw herself to her death even if she wanted to.
You haven't been honest with me. That's why I've slowly distanced myself from you and left you to your own devices.
Please, my liege, tell me how I've been dishonest.
It wasn't a question, but a demand. Perhaps she was done playing the game. Or maybe she would play it on her terms, and the Ascendant would be forced to do something drastic.
A few months ago, something happened in this room.
He didn't look at her as he spoke, and his voice was mild, as if he were talking about the cloudy weather outside.
I'm sure I don't have to go into detail, but I will, just so there can't be any misunderstanding. I know you're not a stupid woman, Luna. You know that everything that happens within these walls is monitored, tracked, analyzed, and categorized. There's no reason for us to act like this isn't the case. A few months ago, you spoke to an empty room. You said something like, "Who's there?" And then you began to sob, to shake.
She sat. He met her eyes now and saw the knowledge on her face. He saw something else, too. Fear. Had she thought he hadn't noticed? That something so severe would slip past him? Perhaps she had, given the amount of time that had passed, but that was why he'd done all this, to soften her up before the blow.
I want to know two things, and I want to remind you that it's important you're truthful here. However smart or capable you think you are, I promise you I'm more so. However great your genes are, remember who you're talking to. I say all that because I don't want harm to come to you. First, I want to know what happened. Who were you talking to? Why did you begin to sob and shake? Second, I want to know why you didn't tell me what happened.
He let silence fill the room. Something he hadn't expected occurred. Tears filled Luna's eyes. She reached up slowly with her shaking right hand and tried to wipe them away. Her face turned to the floor, and a single tear dropped into her lap. She was quiet as she brought her other hand to her face, trying to stop the tears that wanted to flow.
I don't know, and that's not a lie.
Alexander didn't think she was lying. Not knowing and not having an opinion were very different things, however.
What do you think happened then? Was someone in the room with you?
That was what the damn fathers had said. The ex-Titan had moved across the universe like a ghost, floating from planet to planet and room to room. That was their theory.
You wouldn't believe me if I told you.
She was still not looking him in the eyes.
Dear gods, no. She can't be about to tell me the same thing. Tell me, and do not lie.
She took her hands away from her face and smiled through the tears.
I thought Alistair was in the room with me. I thought I heard his voice. I didn't tell you because it sounds insane. Even now, I feel crazy saying it out loud.
She looked up at him.
I didn't tell you because it's impossible.
Alexander felt a deep cold settling in his stomach. The fathers and this bitch had told him the same thing. This Alistair Kane had traveled the universe, breaking the laws of physics, the laws of nature, and no one knew how he did it. Alexander tried to swallow, but his mouth and throat were dry.
Has it happened again?
She shook her head. The tears had stopped as suddenly as they'd started. She wiped away those still on her face.
No, nothing has happened since. I must be losing my mind.
Alexander stood.
Maybe not.
It was time to go to the fathers. Caius de Gracilis had done as his ascendant asked. He had returned to Mars and begun preparing for what might be the Commonwealth's first real test. He had also begun physically preparing himself for war. He didn't think he would be able to face this Titan down. The Ascendant might call him a former Titan, but Caius believed you could never remove the title. That wasn't the purpose of his training. Caius simply knew no way to go to war except by leading. He would fight whatever came to the Commonwealth right beside his men. Caius had heard about the Titans' newest victory. The man had somehow gotten hold of an entire army, and from the whispers that came to Caius's ears, they were all mutants. Caius was a student of history, as most men of his stature had to be. The difference between him and the Ascendant was he didn't have the same arrogance. He didn't look at the Commonwealth as a force that couldn't be defeated, because his bloodline hadn't started the government. Caius believed it could be defeated since it was only as strong as the people who ruled it. Just as those who would come for the mantle were only as strong as their leaders. That was where Caius found himself worrying. He had assessed the Propraetors and the Ascendant and had found them all lacking, at least compared to the Titan, who was quickly turning into a legend. Had the Commonwealth grown soft over the years? Had the leaders not been challenged enough when training for their positions? Caius understood the answer was yes. It had to be yes. What challenge was there to be had without war? What strife was there with boundless energy being mined? The Ascendant had fucked up with this Titan and was coming to know strife. He now knew war and loss, and that could either break a man or make him unbreakable. It would appear, from Caius's perspective, that the man wasn't breaking. Perhaps he wasn't even bending. Caius had kept his grandson a secret from the solar system. Not that people weren't aware he existed, but they didn't understand the way Caius had raised him. The Titan hadn't seen as far as this threat from outside the Commonwealth, but he did have desires for his lineage. He had always believed that if you had a monarchy, the strongest should hold it. To have a monarchy with a weak leader was simply asking for destruction. Caius had planned long into the future. His son was to be a politician, and his grandson, a warrior. The plan had been going well until his son died tragically and accidentally, leaving only the warrior. Now, though, the politician wasn't needed, but a warrior. And if the Commonwealth survived this coming assault, there wasn't any reason power shouldn't change hands. Caius had summoned his grandson, Hector de Gracilis, from the far reaches of Mars a week ago. The grandson was a good man and knew his duty to Mars, to the Gracilis name, and to his grandfather. He finished his job on the other side of the planet and then traveled to see his grandfather, which was how it should be. Now Caius sat in his private dining room, and a servant entered.
My liege, your grandson has arrived.
Caius stood from the table, his meal mostly untouched. He hadn't known exactly when his grandson would arrive, only having trusted the young man would make it. In his early 20s, Hector was as responsible as any ruler Caius knew.
Please allow him to enter.
Very good, my liege.
A man that towered over both the servant and Caius stepped into the room. His shoulders were 1.5 times wider than Caius's, and he stood a meter taller. One would expect to see red eyes in that massive body, but there was no hint of the color, not even under the most intense inspection. That had been one of the most important pieces of this whole endeavor, ensuring that no red remained in his grandson's eyes. Caius had made him a mutant as a young man, though he hated the term. He'd hoped his son's political status would be able to reverse the prevailing hatred of mutants, but if not, Caius wasn't taking any chances. There might be suspicions, but except for the man standing in front of him, every mutant had red irises. Not this one. The grandson dropped to one knee and bowed his head.
My liege.
Stand, stand!
Caius extended his hand and took hold of his grandson's shoulder. The man stood, and Caius put both hands on his biceps.
You look good, Hector. How are things on the other side of Mars?
The rebellion is finished.
Small rebellions happened from time to time on all planets. Things that had nothing to do with subversives, simply men or women whose eyes were bigger than their stomachs. Hector had a relatively fresh cut running down the side of his neck and continuing below his maroon shirt.
Were you injured?
Hector's eyes widened for a second. Then he realized what his grandfather meant and smiled.
No, just got a little too frisky in a battle. Barely a flesh wound, grandfather.
Come, sit.
Caius gestured at the table against the window. Hector nodded, walked over, and sat in the second chair, making everything look small. Caius glanced at the servant, who was still standing at the door.
Please, bring my grandson some food.
The servant nodded, obviously having been waiting for the command.
That's okay, Grandfather.
Nonsense. You will eat with an old man. I still have a full plate, after all.
Caius looked at his grandson across the table.
Do you know why I called you here?
No, sir.
Caius knew his grandson wouldn't lie to him, but he'd been busy killing rebels for the last few months. He knew about strife and danger. Caius leaned back in his chair and looked at the plate of food.
A true rebellion is coming, Hector. Not like the things we have here on Mars.
He tapped his fork absent-mindedly with his forefinger.
A rebellion that will threaten us all. Everything. Mars, Earth, every remaining planet within the Commonwealth's grasp.
He put his hand in his lap, but didn't look up.
I don't know about the people of the Commonwealth, but those like you and me, the ruling class, we will be killed. Anyone who supports us will also be killed.
Does this have to do with Pluto?
No one with any brains believed the farce the communications ministry had put out about Pluto. The subversives had become too powerful, or some nonsense, so an entire planet had to be wiped out of existence.
Yes. You've heard of the Titan Alistair Kane?
Hector's muscled bulk leaned back in his chair.
So that was a lie, too? His death?
Yes.
What would you have me do?
The food was brought in then, and the two men remained quiet as it was served.
Thank you, Alfred.
The servant left, and Hector didn't move to touch his food. Caius continued, ignoring his food as well.
The Ascendant has asked me to call a meeting with the Propraetors. All of them. We're meeting with him in a week. We're going to start preparing then, but until that time, I need you to read up on this Titan Kane.
Yes, of course, Grandfather.
I want you to be at the meeting. I'd like you to take a new position in our family, Hector. You will be my consularius, if you'll take the title.
Most families had the position, and it was an important one. As advisor, a counselor, someone fully trusted who knew all the business of their family's head. Hector stood from the chair, then dropped to one knee.
It would be my honor, Grandfather. The greatest of my life.
Caius touched the young man's head.
Your father would be proud of you, Hector. I know I am. In a week, we will have our coming out party, and then we will decide what to do about this troublesome Titan.
950 years in the past. 50 years after the first Imperial Ascendant, Aurelius De Finita, rose to power. Aurelius De Finita was a man who understood risk and knew eternal vigilance was the necessary price of power. Someone would always try to take the top spot away. It was human nature and could not be helped. When he thought about the future, it wasn't 3 months or 3 years forward. He thought about things in terms of generations. That was why he had started the Artificial Intelligence Project. He understood he had to worry about his progeny. Both those who had escaped his grasp, and Earth, years previously, and the young son he had fathered after they left. He had no optimistic belief that his children would one day return to Earth and bring peace when they came, nor did he think his current son would be ready to rule when the time came. Aurelius was much too old, and someone would try to steal the child's birthright. That was why he had begun the project, which many had called impossible. They said the science wasn't ready, and it wouldn't be ready until long after he was dead. Aurelius wasn't a man who listened to others' limitations, and he hadn't when he started this project either. He'd ignored them all. Now, it was nearly at fruition. The artificial intelligence program would be powered on within the next 48 hours. In early tests, they'd shown it was impossible to upload a human mind without harm to either the AI programming or the mind. Of course, as with all things great men tried to do, there was now a problem. Aurelius hadn't seen this one coming, though. The people who worked on the project had all been thoroughly vetted, psychologically, physically, in every possible way, and then approved. At least, that was what was supposed to have happened. If it had, Aurelius wouldn't be standing in front of this locked door, ready to enter and talk to the man threatening to fuck up the entire endeavor. Aurelius was much older now than when his children had abandoned him and the Commonwealth. 20 years had passed, and he could no longer deny that he was an old man. He still had some of the strength he had once possessed, but much had left him. The only thing that had not left was his will. It was still iron, unbreakable, despite how old he grew. Aurelius waited for a minute, knowing that the man was inside. When no answer came, he took a key card out of his coat pocket and flashed it across the panel to the right of the door. The door opened, and Aurelius saw the man he'd come here to talk to sitting in a wooden chair 3 meters from the door. He was sweating profusely, and he held a weapon of some kind in his hand. Aurelius thought it might be one of the star beams that had become so popular lately. His deceased wife had shot him with one 2 decades previously, before they'd started to be mass-produced. Aurelius stepped into the apartment, and the door swiftly shut behind him.
Do you know who I am?
The man's eyes were bloodshot. He was younger than Aurelius by many years, and had most likely seen little of this world, let alone the universe. He nodded at the Ascendant.
Good.
Aurelius moved farther into the room, looking at the furnishings. The young man's name was Renyard, and from what Aurelius had recently learned, he was a genius. The kid had a bright future ahead of him in the Commonwealth. He could have made a contribution. No longer.
You have something of mine. You stole it from me, and I want it back.
The starbeam shook in the young man's hand, though the barrel remained pointed at Aurelius. The Ascendant paid it no mind.
Where's the algorithm? Is it here?
You're too late.
Aurelius smiled at that.
You can put the weapon down, Renyard. The building has been evacuated.
He turned to look out the window on his right.
Right now, there are at least 5 weapons aimed at your head. And the moment your finger contracts the tiniest bit, your skull will be cracked open like a nut.
He walked over to a small table in front of the window. A picture of an older woman sat on it. The Ascendant knew it was Renyard's mother. He knew everything about the young man. Aurelius picked it up and looked at it for a second, before placing it gently back on the table.
There's not much I can do for you, Renyard. Your fate was sealed the moment you decided to take the algorithm. But you're not thinking about the other people you care about. Your mother is still alive and lives only 20 kilometers from here. Am I right? You see her every Sunday. She used to make lunch for you, but now you're making it for her because she's not as young as she used to be.
The Ascendant turned and looked at the young man. His face was pale, his hand shaking.
You ought to be careful with that weapon. The way your hands are shaking, you might accidentally flex your trigger finger a bit too hard, and that'll be the end of everything.
He stepped across the room and took a seat on another chair, this one having much more cushion and a leather back instead of wood.
Where's the algorithm, Renyard?
The young man stared at him. A drop of sweat hit his eye, causing him to blink. He quickly reached up and wiped it away.
I don't have it.
We know you copied it. We know you took it. We know it's here. The longer you make me ask these questions, the worse it's going to be for your mom, your sister Andrea, and your cousins. Yes, Renyard, I know about them all. I know where they live, and I know where they eat lunch. I might look old and feeble, but looks can be deceiving. Tell me where it is and save them a lot of pain.
Both of them knew what the problem was and why Renyard stealing the algorithm was a massive issue. Aurelius was still in possession.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.